commissioners. And as it is a special meeting, we are required by the Open Public Meetings Act to stick right to our agenda. We will start out with a introduction of our invited guests. And first of all, I should mention that we are the Board of County Commissioners, in case some I'm aware of that. I'm John Austin, I'm currently the chair. On my right, Bill Johnson, County Commissioner, and on his right is David Sullivan. So if we could perhaps start at that end of the table and then move toward the center. And when you introduce yourself from the DOE or from NOAA, if you could also tell us what your role is within that organization.
I'm Cedar and I work in the headquarters office in the Shoreline Environmental Assessment Program. And my main role for the program is communications and outreach. And in that role, I coordinated the Bouta poll. And I'm also tasked to write a handbook chapter of guidance for our local governments on aquaculture. So my role here today is really just to listen and to learn.
Hello, my name is Paula Ehlers, and I'm a section manager for Ecology's Southwest Regional Office, which includes Jefferson County, for the Shoreline Environmental Assistance Program. So my role in this is I supervise a team of about six planners who help local governments through the Shoreline Master Program process, among other things. But, so I actually supervise Jeffrey's work.
Hi, my name is Lori LeVander, and I work for the Department of Ecology, and I'm an aquaculture specialist. I work out of the Bellevue office, which is our Northwest region. I manage individual and NPDES and state waste discharge permits, so National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, a federal permit for any kind of industrial facility. So I manage net 10 permits. I write them and manage.
Hi, my name is Brian Lynn, and I manage our Coastal and Shoreline section, which is a headquarters section in the Department of Ecology and the Shoreline Environmental Assistance Program. So while Paula's working with staff that work directly out in contact with our local governments, we're updating the master plan, doing permitting work and other kinds of work. Our section deals with some of the more of the policy, the technical support, and the grants supports to local governments. So I manage a team of folks there, and staff in my section will actually complete the final review, provide assistance to our regional offices, weigh in on some of these challenging policy issues, and make recommendations to the director of the Department of Ecology, who would make the final decision on the Shoreline Master Program.
Jeff and Stuart with the Southwest Regional Office. I've been working in Jefferson County and other North Peninsula jurisdictions on Shoreline Master Program updates.
My name is Mike Russ. I'm with the NOAA Fisheries. The last 20 years, I've been at the lab in Seattle and Manchester. My training background is mostly fish physiology, nutrition, biochemistry, and reproduction, various aspects of fish. And we've applied those over the years to things like restoring redfish lake sockeye, other ESA-listed species, looking at culture systems to raise fish that we don't know how to raise yet, like we have some ESA-listed rockies up here, Pacific cod, sailfish, so on and so forth. So in those 20 years, I've used just about every aquaculture system known and seen them change over time, so having a pretty up on technology. Since April, I took on a new role with a national office back in Washington, D.C. And in that role, I'm coordinating various regional labs that NOAA has that work in the area of aquaculture and trying to make sure that the science produced out there is available to decision makers in Washington, D.C.
If I could just add a couple more things. Peter Scallon from our group was going to be here today. Communication challenges with our recent snowstorm, and so Peter is not able to be here today. Peter is the one who is most steeped in the nuance of shoreline policy. So if he can't answer some of your questions fully today. I hope that you'll allow us to come back to you and bring in a little bit more others thinking and to address some of the more nuanced questions here. Also, just note that John Kerwin was also going to be here today from the Department of Fish and Wildlife, and he too had issues with power and snow getting behind last week, so he was not able to make it today.
Thank you. We also have staff from Jefferson County. To my left is Phil Morley, who is our county administrator. We have David Alvarez, who is our counsel, Stacie Hoskins, who is the director of community development, and Paula McConnell, our long-working, long-suffering lead on this Shoreline Master Plan. And we also have Lynn Randall, who is serving as our clerk. So I think Stacie, we will review the in water and fish aquaculture questions for Ecology at this point.
Yes, and I'll hand it over to Michelle McConnell, our lead staff, who can walk us through it. Thank you. Good afternoon, Commissioners. Just a quick run through what's in your packet today. These are materials other than the agenda on the top page. The rest are materials that were provided to you. I just want to make sure you have them in front of you. The first is the series of questions that the board put together for the Ecology team. The second is the working draft or draft list of possible CEP criteria. The next is the website information regarding the infectious skin anemia virus. We've got the letter next from NOAA to Brian Lynn with Ecology. And then the last item is the journal article from biological reviews on culture fish integrated management. So that you have those there for you. And I did just want to note sort of on the Ecology team's behalf that again, because of the inclement weather last week, snow, ice, power outages, unaccessible buildings, networks unaccessible, inaccessible, that the Ecology team, I understand, was not able to access these materials until just this morning. So they had a short review of the questions that were prepared, but I know that they'll do their best to answer as much as they can with you and that dialogue with you. Yes, just to get the nutshell, is of course we know that we're close to finalizing our updated SFP and the issue of in water fish aquaculture is of key concern to the commissioners and of course with Ecology as well. Some of their technical experts, and so the idea today, as you know, for this workshop is just to have some open dialogue with the Ecology team and a little more direct dialogue, and as Brian said, maybe some finer nuances and just make sure that everyone understands each other's positions and to look at what are the options for moving forward.
Great. Can you hear in the back of the room?
There. It would be helpful if we could bring it up just a little bit.
But, thank you. So maybe when you're speaking to us, sort of look like you're not speaking to us.
There's also three documents that I created. One is a WAC, one is the flow chart I created that talks about adoption of an SMP, and the other is actually the WACs and the regulations that are listed in this letter. Concerning the questions. There are WAC 173, 26201, portion of that, and then also WAC 173, 26120, sub 7, and the RCWN 58090, just portions of those WACs, and then also a flowchart I created that relates to how we're supposed to adopt the SMP in terms of how it goes local to ecology, back to local, and back to ecology.
Two other housekeeping announcements. One, in case you haven't realized it, there are very conveniently located restrooms immediately on the other side of this wall with a very highly effective hand dryer, which we can hear when it is employed. And the water screen is a two-hour parking zone. Some of us may have parked on the 24-hour parking zone that's on the same street as the Memorial Field. We will take a break at 3 o'clock to allow those of you who have parked in the two-hour zone to avoid criminal trespass. So next,
we leave it to the board to begin the dialogue with the ecology team. I don't know if the ecology has any open statements, or if you just want to jump right into questions and go through them.
Sure. Is there any statement that NOAA or Ecology wants to make before we jump right into addressing the questions for Ecology? You all have a copy of the questions.
I don't think we appreciate being able to be here and have this conversation with you today. I can't apologize if you weren't able to prepare as well as we would like to proceed, but I hope we have a really constructive dialogue. As things come up during the discussion, I think we can find people who are setting topics a little bit more and take a little bit of time that.
Great. Well, we do have the, we start out with one that you should be able to answer pretty quickly. Question number one. What are the legal and scientific justifications for considering finfish aquaculture to be a water-dependent use when there are clear examples of finfish aquaculture operations located with no connection to surface waters in non-coastal shoreline regions?
Well, let me start from just a little bit on the policy side of this, and I think we respect the last six things as well. And obviously, as a team here, feel free to jump in at any point here and add to this. But I think the basic answer from our perspective is that if it's a water dependent use, it's a preferred use under the Shoreline Management Act. And so just because there might be an alternative use doesn't necessarily take away from the fact that is a water dependent use. Still, it is an allowable preferred use under the Shoreline Act. Just like with marinas, there are alternatives to having to store boats in water. You could put them up on dry land storage, but because just because there's an alternative doesn't mean that you wouldn't be able to cycle marina in the water. So that really just going to come down to are there unacceptable or unmitigable impacts to the use, and that's really the place where we're, I think that we're at with this discussion is just exploring that a little bit more. So I don't know if that's clear. People have questions about that. If anybody wants to add.
Yeah, I guess I would ask, how do you define dependent?
Define what?
Dependent.
Oh.
Yeah, dependent.
Oh. Water dependent.
But not watering, just dependent.
Yeah. Well, I think actually this is. This is probably one of those areas where I'm not going to do this justice. I don't know if you want to take a crack at whether, because the act explains water dependency, water related uses, and water joint uses. And so you could not have, clearly you could not have an open water marine finfish net pen operation without heating that water so that use would be dependent on that water.
And by the same token, you could not have a floating casino out there unless it's floating. So if it's floating, it's water dependent. So is everything water dependent that is floating?
Well, I think you come back to what is the actual use? The use of a casino would be gambling, I guess, what is that gambling, which is not dependent on being located on the water or near the water.
So if fish farming can be done in downtown Milwaukee, for example, on the land, is it not water dependent?
I would say you're talking about uplands.
Right.
That kind of aquaculture would not be dependent on being on the shore, certainly on water at some level. But,
right. So, yeah. So fish farming isn't water dependent, but net pen are water
dependent.
I think that's weighing on when someone applies for a permit for a fish farm, it is dependent on having a water source. So to answer your question of whether it needs to be over the water or upland, there's a process that the applicant goes through called ACAR, also available in reasonable treatment. They have to analyze other options other than putting that floating casino or that net pen in that water. And it's, so the reasonableness part of that acronym is has to be evaluated for every project. So a marina has to evaluate alternatives if they're going to put an arena in. A net pen has to evaluate alternatives. In the last, the environmental impact statement was done for marine net pens, that reasonableness was evaluated and it was determined that putting in an upland with pumping salt water and all the costs associated with that was not reasonable. It did not meet the reasonableness test.
Lori, if I remember right, the conversation we had, you also spoke about there being different kinds of aquaculture facilities upland relative to what is generally proposed in marine environments. Can you speak to that as well?
Yeah, there are hatcheries, there are fishery facilities that are upland. They can use well water, they can pump surface water into their facility. I am not aware, on the first question here, I'm not aware of any clear examples of marine and fish aquaculture operations located upland or successful that bring marine water in. So, I guess that's a question I have. I'm not aware of that, but it does need to be valuable. But a hatchery, for example, could be located if it's raising different age classes of fish, but adult salmon that are dependent on marine waters. I'm not aware of any.
There's adult salmon, not